afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all in this panel discussion. I'm Amrita, and it gives me immense pleasure to bring this panel discussion presented by Ace Perkins, dealers of Jaguar Land Rover, Pune. So today we will be sharing how this COVID-19 pandemic has affected the entire real estate sector and what the future holds basically, and how the luxury real estate will look or will have the impact today. So before starting this discussion, I will just take 1 minute to introduce our panel members. We have Siddharth Vasudevamurthy, MD Vascon Engineering Limited. We have Ms. Gunjan Goyal, Director Goyal Ganga Developers. We have Rishikesh Manzrekar, Executive Director Amar Builders. We have Harish Shroff with us, Director Sales and Marketing and Business Development, Nyati Group. We have Mayuri Shende Kankarial, Director Commercial Leasing and Operations, Abhinav Group. And then we have Ashish Jain, MD Kundan Space. So in this entire lockdown and in this pandemic, we have seen that there's a major economic slowdown. People have lost their jobs like anything. In recent data, they said that in India in last 5 months, from April, 2 crore people have lost their jobs. So it shows that how serious it is. So my question now is to Mr. Siddharth Murthy. So I would like to know from you, considering the high cost of luxury homes, do you think that the demand for luxury homes will go down for a longer period? Or contrary, you think that there will be something else? How do you look at it?
I think over this lockdown period, people have really realized the importance of a house. And I think people who have realized the importance of a house have also realized the importance of having extra space in their house. Today, you know, we talk about work from home. There is also school from home. So space has become a very important criteria. And we see many instances where people are, people who have 2 bedrooms are looking for 3 bedrooms. People who are 3 are looking for that additional room. That need has automatically come about having extra space in your house. We ourselves are seeing increased demand, and we're seeing more inquiry in our luxury projects right now. And luxury projects typically have minimal inventory and they're in prime location. So luxury projects are not mass housing, and therefore you don't have 300, 400, 500 units to sell. You are typically in a range of maybe between 25 and 75 units that you need to sell. So, luxury housing will, going forward, the demand, I believe, will be strong.
Mr. Murthy, I would like to know your views on the same question. Do you see that shift from big cities to smaller cities, considering affordable housing?
Absolutely. See, smaller cities have always been the flavor of affordable housing. And even the government initially gave a very good push with housing for all. Unfortunately, all the stakeholders to make this happen have not been in sync. For example, a person who wants to buy a house in a sub 20, 25 lakh range today, for him, funding is a challenge, getting a loan is a challenge. Public banks will not support him unless all his documentation is in his place. And if he chooses to go to NBFCs, the rate of interest is much higher, which then makes the house unaffordable. So whenever we come up with a program which is the need of the hour for a country like ours, all stakeholders should support it. It's not just you can't just put it in the hands of a developer and say you do it. Everyone has to support it, and then it will go through. That's the reason cities like Pune and tier 2 cities really do well in affordable housing. The reason being that the cost of living over here is really reasonable. The cost of housing over here is much reasonable compared to other cities of an equal standard across the country, say Bangalore or Hyderabad. And right. That's why, Pune is always a preferred destination. Also in terms of, you don't see fantastic appreciations over the past few years in Pune, but you don't see significant drops in the value of houses, unlike say Mumbai, where at one time a house you would buy at over 1 lakh rupees a square feet, and then there's a drop to say 80,000 and 70,000 rupees a square feet. You don't see dramatic changes like that over here. So your investment is pretty safe. And that's why, you know, people even from outside India prefer to look at cities like
that. What is your view on this? What this pandemic has taught you and made changes in your business?
So I think, like most of you all know, we are a company that does real estate as well as construction. So some of the learnings that we've had is, you know, how on site you need to be quick enough to replace labor with mechanization so that progress is not hurt. That is one of the key things, because in construction, construction, we end up with clients who, a single client who gives us crores of rupees, and you don't want to disappoint these clients. And right. And timelines to them are very crucial because of, the way they do work. Say, for example, airports where we're working as well. In real estate, of course, it's been very important to understand people's needs and react very, empathetically, like everyone said. It's also important to make sure that even if you're not able to solve their problem, they feel that, they have been heard and someone is there to support them through this tough times.
Right.
You know, this is something that none of us planned for. Even in our worst, when we do a pessimistic business plan, we consider that maybe 2 projects out of 10 will not work, and what happens then? Never do we do that. I'm going to be sitting at home for 5 months, and what do we do then? So the whole way of how we've been planning business has changed dramatically. And instead of focusing on, say, long-term plans, we now focus on what is our monthly plan and quarterly plans, with much more focus and with much more eye to detail compared to...
Now, there are some questions coming from our audience. I would like to take this question. What are the key changes in building material and real estate? Mr. Murthy, would you like to say something about this?
Sure. I think in terms of building material, we've seen it's a constant process. And this is something where it's each one to their own. It's based on how companies have adapted themselves to make themselves more cost efficient. So there are instances where we're using hybrid systems for construction, which is neither a completely aluminium formwork nor completely plywood conventional formwork. But we're using systems which have given us speed and less dependency on labor. So those kind of building materials that's what we've been doing to overcome this. In terms of marketing for real estate, again, we've all tried our own strategies. Some have been successful, some have not been as successful. When it comes to luxury housing, we've kept it very niche. We're very careful about where we advertise, where we do branding. We don't just, do it anywhere and anyhow. In terms of affordable housing, we believe in doing it a little much more aggressively. We don't like to keep it subtle. So those kind of changes have happened so that, there is more recognition and there is more recall value from the customers.
I've been discussing. My last question is to Mr. Siddharth Murthy. I would like to know, rather anyone want to answer this, what advice would you like to give to authorities, investors and buyers in this particular time?
Okay, so to investors and to buyers, let's start with them first. The general conception is always that real estate is about location, location, location. But when it comes to luxury real estate specifically, or now even it's filtering down to the mid-segment housing, you have to look beyond location. You need to see what is the location, what is the hard product that you're getting, and what is the soft product that you're getting. What I mean by this is, I mean, everyone knows location, that's self-explanatory, so I'm not getting into that. But the hard product is what you're getting as a house, how the plan is, how efficient it is, what is the usable area. There shouldn't be much or negligible wastage in passages, things like that. But just like a hotel industry, where just having a big room and you know, a comfortable bed does not complete the experience, but it is the service that completes the experience in a five-star hotel. Similarly, in high-end luxury, also it is the entire experience that you know that completes the circuit. So how are you taking care of toddlers? How are you taking care of young kids? How are you taking? What do you have for teenagers? How are you going to take care? What do you have for people? And how are you going to take care of middle-aged people? What about senior citizens? What are you doing for this entire demography? What are you doing? Like, we have projects where we've gone to the extent of even taking care of pets. So this entire experience that you put out there, that is what, you need to see before making a decision, is what I feel. And location alone should not be the decision criteria. Because also, when a time comes where if you choose to sell this to move to a better place or to a different city for whatever reason, you should have, it should not be very difficult to liquidate such a product. And therefore, products like this always have one, a premium while selling, and second, more demand for these products. With the authorities, I think that is a very long topic because we have a lot to say to them. There has to be a very strong push for ease of doing business. Today, I think the timelines that we have from land purchase to actually delivering a project is extremely wrong, extremely, extremely long. Mm. And where we need to find ways to cut that short itself. That itself will give us a lot of breathing space, and it will also, convert into savings for the client, because the shorter the period of work, the less financial implications that are there on the developer. And therefore, these benefits automatically get passed on to the end user.
Right.
So that is definitely something that I would recommend.
It was a very nice discussion. Even the audiences are saying that they loved it. It was in depth. And all of you have given your views very nicely, very sharp views as expected. So these are difficult times for all of us, but it's really nice that you all are very positive. I thank each one of you for participating and giving time and giving your views. It really means a lot. And thank you very much. Once again, on behalf of Ace Perkins Jaguar Land Rover, I would like to thank you all for joining this conversation and giving your time. Thank you so much, guys. And take care. Difficult times, but I'm sure we all will sail through it very nicely, very safely, and all the best to each one of you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.